Yeah. Analytics, all the chain, all the channels, not the same. Jake and Kyle, you know the name. Headline Nation, we running the game.
What is going on, Headliner Nation? Jake, Fantasy Headliners. Hopefully everybody's doing well out there as we head into week 13 fantasy football, talking about some running backs so we can start or sit here. Very, very crucial week in fantasy football as we get ready to head in to the fantasy playoffs. Now, got a couple items of business here to take care of. First things first, how did we do in week 12 of fantasy football? And at the running back position, we absolutely killed it here once again. Out of the 59 running backs we gave a start or sit designation to, 47 of them were correct for an accuracy percentage of, once again, 80% here this past week. Some of the biggest misses, Dontrell Hilliard, David Montgomery disappointing against the Lions. Najee Harris totally disappeared because they got blew out by the Cincinnati Bengals. Some of the bigger hits, Elijah Mitchell, Javonte Williams out there looking like a stud, and then Miles Gaskin as well performing for so many fantasy players here this past week. And so overall, a great, great week for the running back position. But we also have some cash to give away, right? $500 cash from the November giveaway through Prize Picks. And you know what? It's time to announce that winner right now. So the winner of the $500 cash for signing up through Prize Picks in the month of November is Trayvon Evans. Congratulations, Trayvon, on winning $500 cash to get yourself something a little bit extra nice here during the holiday season. But before we head into every matchup, every player, every game, I got to be transparent, got to be, you know, full disclosure to you guys. I have not been feeling well for like over a week, and it's not the easiest thing for me right now to kind of get in front of the camera and act like everything is all perfect and fine. So if my jokes aren't as good today, or if the energy just isn't there like it normally is, it's all good. I'm just not feeling the greatest, but the show must go on. You need your information. You got lineups to set, and we're gonna start with the running back position right now. Thursday Night Football, the Dallas Cowboys and New Orleans Saints. And there's going to be a common theme here today. We're just looking for guys with pulses at this point because injuries are all over the NFL. And if somebody's a full participant and getting any type of workload, now we're going to have to start them, right? Because our options are pretty thin here for week 13. We'll talk about them here in all these matches. But the first one here, we have a short week and a stud injured running back still, Alvin Kamara. Does he return this week? Well, he's back at practice in a limited form and fashion. So that's at least he's trending the right direction. But I'm not overly optimistic with it being this short week that we for sure see him. What I do think we have is Mark Ingram, who's back at practice as a full participant. I'll take one over none any day of the week, but this New Orleans team really needs both of them. In this backfield last week without either one of them, they combined for 22 carries for 41 freaking yards. That is absolutely horrendous. Now they go up against the Dallas Cowboys, who allow right around 19 fantasy points per game, and we know New Orleans needs these playmakers in their offense. Both of these running backs, when healthy, in this backfield can average over 15 touches in a game and are definitely starts every single week. Mark Ingram more of a weekly flex play. If there's no Alvin Kamara, obviously he bumps up the rankings. And if Kamara is active and healthy, we already know he's already in our lineup every single week. Anyway, for Dallas, it's just another year of people coming out and saying that Tony Pollard is a better running back than Zeke Elliott. Stop. No. He's not. Now, sure, Zeke hasn't been dominant, you know, as of late, but this entire offense hasn't looked dominant as of late in Dallas. They've lost three out of their last four games. They have had no late game leads to really concentrate on running the ball with Zeke Elliott. Plus, Zeke's still getting the targets. He's had 14 of them over the last two games. He's seventh in the NFL in rushing, seventh in the NFL in rushing touchdowns, and they're just lacking big plays because he only has two carries over 20 yards, a couple big runs, and people will kind of forget about Tony Pollard here just a little bit. But it's not like Pollard is out there absolutely killing it. He was really saved by a kick return touchdown just this past week. Now they get New Orleans, though, who is number one in the NFL against opposing running backs, allowing only 14 fantasy points per game. Now, Jerry Jones has already come out and says he expects Zeke Elliott to get a serious load. Not exactly what I'd want to be given to me. But anyway, for Zeke, obviously he's healthy. He's going to be a start. Now, if, you know, word comes out later in the week that they are going to be resting him, that they are going to transition more work to Pollard, then we'll take that, you know, at that time. But as of right now, Zeke is still the guy in this backfield. Tony Pollard not getting enough consistent touches to really be somebody that we warrant a flex play here this week. Now, obviously, if you are desperate and you have no other options, then yeah, Tony Pollard is going to be somebody who's inside my top 40 rankings, but he's not going to be ranked too high. And even though I'm not feeling the greatest, we're still going to thrust it over to Sunday football, where we have the Tampa Bay Buccaneers and Atlanta Falcons. And how good is it to have Cordarrelle Patterson back in your lineup? He is the entire Atlanta Falcons offense, and he's coming off a season high in carries with 16, plus had his first 100-yard rushing day. I mean, we really like this guy because of his involvement in the passing game. And over the past few weeks, we're starting to see a little bit more there on the ground. He's actually only had 3 combined receptions over the last 2 games played. Now, he excelled in the passing in the last time these two teams met against Tampa Bay in week 2, where he had 7 targets for 5 receptions, 58 yards, and a touchdown. Now, Tampa Bay is a tough start for any running back there in the NFL. They are allowing only right around 16 fantasy points per game. But Cordarrelle Patterson is no average running back in the way that he's being utilized. The opposing defenses can be, you know, taking advantage either through the air or on the ground. We know Tampa Bay is a little bit more vulnerable to pass catching running backs, so we're obviously going to start Cordarrelle Patterson. For Tampa Bay, Lenny out there living up to his name, Fournette, with 4 touchdowns just this past week. Plus, he's coming off his first 100-yard rushing game, and he played in over 81% of the snaps. He's still getting the passing work, which is a plus. He's not losing that. He's had 6-plus receptions now in 3 straight games, and he gets a matchup this week going up against the Atlanta Falcons, who allow the 10th most points to opposing running backs at 19 fantasy points per game. The touchdowns, they can keep on coming. We're going to start Leonard Fournette because this offense is just so explosive. It gives him all those scoring opportunities. Now, we've started to see Ronald Jones get a little bit more involved, but it's really just the touchdowns in back-to-back games. He's not getting, you know, high snap percentages. He's not seeing a lot of touches in the backfield. He's just capitalizing on what he is getting. So it's definitely something we're not going to start Ronald Jones yet because the volume just isn't there. But down the stretch, if Tampa Bay can get a large lead in the division, we could see a little bit more Ronald Jones down the stretch. He hasn't played more than 15 snaps in a game since week 2. So for right now, still going to sit ourselves some Ronald Jones. Over to Arizona and Chicago now, and the Cardinals just set themselves up for a great late season push. I mean, they rested Kyler Murray a few weeks. They rested DeAndre Hopkins. Now they're coming off their bye week. They didn't rush them back from their injuries. And now all of a sudden, are they healthy and ready to make a run into the NFL playoffs? Because if they are, if they have these studs back, it's going to help the overall offense, which is good things for James Conner here in this backfield, who's already having his best year since 2018. He's had touchdowns in 8 of his last 9 games played, at least 4 targets now in 3 straight games. No Chase Edmonds in this backfield as of yet. And he's getting right around 25 touches 2 out of the last 3 games he's played. Plus, we like the opportunity that Arizona could have this week in having a late game lead, really relying on James Conner in the fourth quarter to kind of close it down. The Bears allowed around 18 fantasy points per game. We're going to start ourselves some James Conner. For Chicago, dang it, we were kind of hoping that last week was the last week of Matt Nagy, but nope, he's still there. But going into week 12, had you told me that David Montgomery was going to see 20 touches against the Detroit Lions, I would have been like, yeah, that is sexy. That's what I want. Then he did nothing with it, really, right? 74 total yards, disappointing performance, didn't really, you know, exceed expectations against such a lowly opponent. But the problem here this week is, once again, I can see Chicago falling behind and kind of abandoning the run. Does that mean that we sit David Montgomery? I don't think we can afford to sit David Montgomery. But we have a solid run defense in the Arizona Cardinals coming off their bye week, in which they had an extra week to prep for this game. And we have an offense that's already struggling in Chicago to move the ball down the field consistently in any form or fashion. David Montgomery is not somebody that you could probably sit, right? There's just not a lot of options out there. He's one of those guys that I said, hey, 20 touches, and he's got a pulse. So he's probably in your lineup. But I'm tempering expectations this week. He's going to be a little bit lower in my rankings because I just don't love this matchup. Which takes us up to Cincinnati for the Chargers and the Bengals. My Manscaped matchup of the week here this week. Just a reminder, the holiday season right around the corner. Head over to manscaped.com. Get yourself something nice for your travel bag. They got all kinds of things that are not just ball trimmers, fellas. Just make sure to use that promo code HEADLINERS at checkout. Get yourself 20% off and free shipping. But back to this matchup. This is just such a no-brainer, right? A matchup of running back 2 overall versus running back 3 overall. There's only 3 running backs in fantasy football in half PPR scoring that have over 200 points scored this season. Jonathan Taylor, and then these two guys, Austin Eckler and Joe Mixon. Joe Mixon now has had 2 touchdowns in 4 straight games. That's an absurd pace. He's not splitting touches with anybody in this backfield, and he's playing 70% of the snaps. Austin Eckler, we know what he's doing. He's scoring touchdowns. He's getting targets in the passing game, at least 6-plus targets in 5 out of the last 6 games played. Both teams allow over 18 fantasy points per game, and the Chargers are allowing right around 24 fantasy points per game, so it could be another big day for Mixon. But as for Eckler, Mixon, no brainers, they're definitely starts. Now we head over to Detroit for the Minnesota Vikings, Detroit Lions, and the exact opposite of a no-brainer here, right? Because we got a couple of banged up stud running backs. Dalvin Cook, with a torn labrum or not. I mean, it came out initially reported that's what it was. Then they came out and said, nah, that's not what it is. He's day to day. Whatever it is, Dalvin Cook is not 100% healthy. And DeAndre Swift himself, a long shot to play this week as well. At least we can kind of look at it like this. There's a lot of question marks surrounding both these guys, right? But at least in Minnesota, if we know we don't have Dalvin Cook, we know we can plug and play Alexander Mattison. We've seen this play out before. When Cook is not in the lineup, Mattison is definitely a top 12 to top 15 start at the running back position each and every week. But what about Detroit? I mean, do we just plug and play Jamal Williams? I mean, he's not really going to have anybody to split with in this backfield. It's a good matchup because the Vikings allow right around 20 fantasy points per game, 10th most in the NFL. And we know that Jamal Williams is three down capable. The problem is he's going to have limited scoring opportunities because the Lions, they don't score very many points. It's a lower ceiling. He's still going to remain a start for me, but he's going to be a little bit lower in my rankings. As for Alexander Mattison, he gets a matchup against these Lions who allow over 22 fantasy points per game. We're kind of just waiting to see what happens here, right? If both these studs sit, then I'll go to their backups as starts this week. I think they have the potential to fill in nicely in a good matchup here in week 13. Down to South Beach we go for the Miami Dolphins and New York Giants. And any coincidence with Miami going 4-0 over their last four games, with the touches going the way of Myles Gaskin also increasing over that same span? No? Maybe? Okay, probably. Four straight games now with at least 15 touches for Myles Gaskin, and he's had touchdowns in three out of the last four he's played. But you have to think, with the signing of Philip Lindsay, he's going to eat in to that volume just a little bit. Just last week, Philip Lindsay had only been in town for like 6 minutes almost, and he still had 12 touches in that game. Plus, he's very motivated to go out there and be a big part of this offense. Full disclosure, I love myself some Philip Lindsay. I think he's highly underrated in this league and can go out there and put up some big numbers when given the opportunity. That worries me. I have to think that Brian Flores and the Miami Dolphins don't give two craps about our fantasy football teams. Gaskin has just played the fewest snaps in a game that we've seen since week six, with only 37. 50% of the snaps. That makes him a lot more touchdown dependent going forward. Now, the New York Giants, they allow right around 22 fantasy points per game, fifth most in the NFL. We need people, right? We need people to start. So you know what? I'll start Gaskin still for that touchdown upside. We've seen it over the last few weeks. We know he's still the most familiar in this offense, but I can't rank him too high in a good matchup just due to the Philip Lindsay factor. As for Philip Lindsay, as much as in my heart, I want to think that they go out there and give this kid 10 to 15 touches a week, it's still a little bit too much of a risk because we haven't seen him do it in this offense just yet. He's a little bit more of a deep flex. Maybe you're in a 14-team league. Maybe you're in a 12-team league that starts three or four flexes and you just need somebody. Then I don't hate Philip Lindsay. If you're in a normal 10 to 12-man league and you're just looking for those top 24 guys, I will not have Lindsay that high, and that's where he'll remain a sit. For New York, we need more Saquon Barkley, and this could be the week we get it because there's a great chance that we don't have Daniel Dimes, Danny Pennies, Daniel Jones, whatever it is. It doesn't matter because Daniel Jones isn't that great. We haven't seen anything good from Daniel Jones since he tripped over that invisible sprinkler head. But that's like the last thing I can really remember. I was like, oh, I remember Daniel Jones for that reason. And it's not even a good reason to remember him. But that just means we could see a lot more reliance on the running game and Saquon Barkley here this week. But the problem is when we've seen Saquon over this season so far, he's not doing a whole lot with the ball when he gets it. He hasn't had a game all year long in which he's averaged over 4.5 yards per carry. Overall, this offense just isn't good. They're not getting scoring opportunities consistently. Now, obviously, another one of those situations where you can't sit touches. In a week like this, with potentially no Daniel Jones under center, we could see 20-plus touches from Saquon Barkley, which puts him right there in that start category. Miami allows over 18 fantasy points per game. Cross your fingers and hope for a big Saquon day. Over the other New York team now for the Jets and the Eagles. And let me get this straight. So a couple weeks ago, we lose Michael Carter in this backfield for the Jets, and he was doing pretty good, right? He's had a string there of, you know, double digit games. He was finally starting to come into his own, really dominating this backfield. And then he gets hurt. So you have to think that, all right, halfway through the season, Ty Johnson had been a pretty decent other option in this backfield. He's going to get a bigger role, right? No, it's Tevin Coleman, who still can't find a hole to run through. And it's Austin Walter. Do you know who the hell Austin Walter is? I know you didn't own him in fantasy football. His ownership percentage is like zero, and nobody started him. Why? Because it's Austin Walter, and he plays for the Jets. This backfield is just a complete mess and one I'm avoiding altogether. Philadelphia may allow right around 17.5 fantasy points per game, but overall, this offense is just not good in New York, and they're not really utilizing the passing game with any of these running backs, which is the one thing that we could look at to try to find the guy with the safer floor. It's not happening. They're too risky. They're all sits. For Philadelphia, we have a banged up Miles Sanders here once again. And then you got Nick Sirianni out there looking like a Backstreet Boy coming off a weekend bender. It's just a recipe for disaster once again in the backfield of the Philadelphia Eagles. Now, Jalen Hurts, he's just out there. He's handcuffing the entire offense, right? He can't get going in the passing game. He's taking a ton of the rushing opportunities. It's just really no consistency to anybody in this backfield. The scoring opportunities just aren't there. Jordan Howard could be coming back this week. We know about Boston Scott and Kenny Gainwell there as well, splitting touches. But what sucks is this is such a good matchup, right? The Jets allow over 27 fantasy points per game to opposing running backs, but who is going to be the guy this weekend? If Miles Sanders sits, I think that clears the skies a little bit for Boston Scott. But then what happens if Jordan Howard returns? There's just too many what ifs in this backfield that I really prefer to avoid altogether. As of right this second, until we get more word, Boston Scott will be my highest ranked running back in this backfield. He would be the guy that I take the gamble on as of right now. But I'm hoping that there's more clarity heading into the weekend, because honestly, I don't want anything to do with this backfield. Over to Houston now for the Colts and the Texans. Can anybody tell me why, you know, Frank Reich all of a sudden thought it was a good idea to somewhat abandon Jonathan Taylor at times during their game just this last week? Because honestly, I don't see it. I don't understand why this guy cannot be stopped. Give him the ball all four quarters. Don't try to be cute with it and sprinkle in Nyheim Hines or whatever. No, give Jonathan Taylor the ball, because he can run on anyone. He just had the fewest touches that he's had in a game in a month. However, he still saw 20 touches, so that's okay. Was it a Nyheim Hines day this past weekend? No, not really. He only had four touches, but now they get a matchup going up against the Houston Texans, a Texans team which allows over 21 fantasy points per game. I'm fully excited right now for all Jonathan Taylor owners, because this is one of those weeks that he could carry you to victory alone. As for Houston, this backfield is just struggling to try to hit 3 yards per carry at this point. They have no holes to run through. They very rarely have a lead to rely on the running game. They abandoned David Johnson halfway through the game. Neither one of these guys are really getting pass catching volume out of the backfield consistently. Rex Burkhead's getting right around 12 to 15 touches, but he's not doing anything with it. And now they have a difficult matchup going up against Indianapolis, who allows only 16.5 fantasy points per game. Not interested. Both David Johnson and Rex Burkhead firmly in the sit column for me here once again this week. Up to Vegas now for the Raiders and the Washington football team, and I'm never here to root for injuries for anybody. But if J.D. McKissick is going to miss some time, Antonio Gibson about to be that workhorse that we want him to be, that we've been waiting for him to be for so long. Plus, he looks healthy. He's coming off a season high in touches with 36. Plus, this means he'll get the pass catching work as well, because he's also had a season high in targets just this past week. And he gets a good matchup going up against the Las Vegas Raiders, who allow over 20 fantasy points per game. Great timing for Antonio Gibson to get hot and carry your team to the fantasy playoffs. For Las Vegas, they really remain committed to Josh Jacobs as of right now in this backfield as of late. Kenyon Drake hasn't had at least 10 fantasy points in 3 straight weeks. He hasn't played more than 18 offensive snaps in 3 straight weeks. So Josh Jacobs is going to be the guy who's going to get the volume in this backfield. He's coming off a game in which he had 24 total touches, also had 4+ targets now in 4 straight games. So they're starting to utilize him that way as well. Going up against Washington, they're already in 17 fantasy points per game. Josh Jacobs has been playing a little bit better. This offense looks a little bit better at times. Darren Waller is banged up. They're going to need more options that could really, you know, bode as something well for Josh Jacobs here in week 13. And that's why he's going to remain the guy in this backfield and remain the guy in the start column. Over to LA now for the Rams and the Jags, and another injury that we need to watch here for Daryl Henderson, suffering from a quad injury. How limited is he this weekend? Does he play? Does he miss this game? If he does, we can tell you one thing. It's going to kind of be a plug-and-play backfield with Sony Michel, who will get the bulk of the touches and will become start-worthy in this backfield if we do not have Daryl Henderson. Worst-case scenario here is he goes into the weekend, he's a game-time decision, and you really don't know what to do late in the game. Maybe you have both of these guys. Maybe you have Sony Michel Michel as a handcuff on your bench, and then you'll be okay because you know that you can plug and play either one. But as of right now, we're waiting to get more news on Daryl Henderson to find out what's going to happen in this backfield because they're going up against the Jacksonville Jaguars, who let right around 18.5 fantasy points per game. Either one of these guys, if given the full workload, could be a decent start for you here this week. For Jacksonville, James Robinson continues just to be a solid mid to low end running back two every single week, right? He's just consistent. His ceiling is not huge because he plays for the Jags and they're always losing, and he really can't get those huge ceiling games like we maybe saw just this past year, but he's been consistent, and that's what it's all about. He's had touchdowns in 6 of his last 8 games. No big time chair in this backfield. He's commanding the bulk of the touches. Now a matchup against the Rams is not ideal. They allow around 17 fantasy points per game, but the floor being so safe, he's going to remain in the start column. Another one of those days that wouldn't surprise me if we see 10 to 12 fantasy points or so from James Robinson. Now we head up to Pittsburgh for the Ravens and the Steelers, and this is always a fun game to watch an interdivisional matchup here, but let's just start off by saying we're going to forget last week's performance from one Najee Harris, because he absolutely disappeared, mostly in part to them being blown out by the Cincinnati Bengals. But man, how bad did Big Ben look? And if Big Ben's going to look that bad, that's really going to hamper the potential production for one Najee Harris, who just had his fewest touches in a game with only 11. Back-to-back games now with less than 60 total yards, an offensive line that's playing horribly and doing him no favors. And then when I actually dived a little bit deeper into the stats, I realized he's only had 3 games all year in which he's averaged at least 4 yards per carry. That tells me he's not efficient behind this offensive line. He needs volume. And in the matchup going up against the Baltimore Ravens, who allowed around 16.5 fantasy points per game, we need Big Ben to step up his game a little bit to try to pull some of those defenders outside of the box to help Najee Harris out. Now, obviously, you can't sit Najee. You can't sit a guy that has that 20-25 touch potential, but I'm a little bit worried about the production that we could see if Big Ben struggles once again this week. For Baltimore, still looking like it's Devontae Freeman in this backfield. He seems to be the man. The problem is this overall offense is just not clicking right now. Lamar Jackson calling his own number, rushing the ball a lot himself, and they're just not getting a whole lot of scoring opportunities overall. If you're looking for that guy in this backfield still, it's Devontae Freeman that has that opportunity around the goal line and seems to be the most explosive option outside of Lamar Jackson in this backfield, and he will be the guy that I start here this week. Up to Seattle now for the Seahawks and 49ers, and how clutch has Elijah Mitchell been here as of late? Love having him in the fantasy lineup as of right now because he's got back-to-back games played with 27 carries, and we've said it for years. We don't care who it is in this backfield. Whoever they're committed to is the guy that you want to start just due to the way the offense runs. Now, he's had 90-plus rushing yards in 4 out of his last 5 games played. He is committed to in this backfield, and now he gets a matchup against the Seattle Seahawks who allow over 25 fantasy points per game. Yeah, you're going to start Elijah Mitchell once again here this week. For Seattle, no, it's just gross. This backfield hasn't done anything in months. The entire offense is struggling. They can't get DK Metcalf involved. They can't get Tyler Lockett involved consistently. Russ is just continually missing passes down the field. The backfield is just a carousel of a mess. Alex Collins basically runs backwards most of the time, and now a matchup going up against the San Francisco 49ers, who are 3rd best in the NFL against opposing running backs. I don't care who is in this backfield, they're all sits. Now we go to Sunday Night Football, the Kansas City Chiefs, Denver Broncos, and we saw CEH return prior to their bye week and look pretty healthy. So now after the bye week, we have to think that they come out and they're ready to go in Kansas City. Love to start some Chiefs players here coming off their bye week and in which a season that they've been somewhat underwhelming, right? Hopefully they had an extra week to prep for this game and they can come out firing on all cylinders. The Denver Broncos allowed right around 18 fantasy points per game to opposing running backs, so I'm going to go ahead and start me some CEH here this week. For Denver, we continue to flex Melvin Gordon and Javonte Williams every single week, right? That safe floor is there. They're really reliant on the running backs in this offense for the Denver Broncos. Now, we've seen Javonte Williams over the last few weeks kind of take a step forward in this offense. If you've watched the games on Sunday, if you've seen the highlights, you can tell this kid is going to be special in the near future. Neither one of them are overly reliant on the pass catching game, which is why one really isn't higher than the other. They're going to be almost back to back in my rankings, and they're both going to be starts here for week 13. Which means we'll end it Monday Night Football with a great matchup between the New England Patriots and Buffalo Bills. And who would have thought that this game would have been so meaningful when we started the year? But Mac Jones, Mac Jones is pretty good, right? And all of a sudden, the New England Patriots are back in the top of this division, and they're making the Bills work for it here once again. Now, do we have a viable Buffalo running back all of a sudden in Matt Breida? Because that's really been the name that's been hot in this backfield here as of late. Well, his volume isn't huge. He only had 11 touches just this past week, but he was saved by a touchdown. Can we really count on weekly touchdowns from the running game of the Buffalo Bills? Not really. Not really against this defense in New England either. They allow only 16 fantasy points per game, and they're getting better as the season is going on. We know there's still going to be a split in this backfield with at least Devin Singletary, because Zach Moss was a healthy scratch because we know he's not good. But I mean, in a primetime game, Buffalo wants to make a statement. I see them airing it out down the field a little bit more, trying to put some points up on the board. I'm going to sit Matt Breida and Devin Singletary here this week, which I guess probably won't be a surprise to a lot of people. For New England, we know they like to run, and they like to run a lot. Now, Damian Harris looks to be back and healthy. He was tops in this backfield in touches once again. We already know he has that touchdown upside every single week. And with Mac Jones playing as well as he is, it's really opening up the run game even more for Damian Harris and Ramondre Stevenson. It's a tough matchup for these guys, though, going up against the Buffalo Bills. They allow only 17 fantasy points per game. Their ceilings are going to be lower, but as of right now, Damian Harris is going to be the guy that I start in this backfield due to the volume that he could see over Ramondre Stevenson. I like Stevenson. I think he's going to be a guy that gets more work maybe in years to come. But as of right now, this is still the backfield of Damian Harris. All right, those are my starts and sits for week 13 here, fantasy football for the running back position. Hopefully I was able to give you a little bit of information on some of the guys on your lineups. A lot of guys we're watching here heading into the weekend to see what their availability is going to be. So many injuries as of right now at the running back position. Find those pulses, right? Just find those guys that are out there playing, plug them in your lineup, and cross your fingers. That's what so many of us are going to be doing here this week heading in to the fantasy playoffs. Once again, congratulations to Trayvon Evans, the winner of our $500 cash giveaway. And if you have ideas, listen, I'll do another giveaway for December for prize picks. Got any ideas? What would you like to see me give away for the month of December? You never know. Maybe I'll take your submission there down below in the comment section. Make it happen here for the month of December. Looking forward to doing that. Hope you guys are having a great rest of your day, though. A great week. And we'll talk to you later.